If you've been on the internet long enough, you've probably seen something like this GIF. Or this image. Or this one. Or even Jesus Christ, this fucking thing. People have been sharing these around on social media, like Twitter, Discord, and the like, for years, usually just for a quick laugh. I imagine a decent chunk wondered, if even for a second, where the hell these came from, and what the original context was. Well, before I answer that, let me give a bit of backstory. This'll be important, I swear. Years ago, before I was big into my current interests of Team Fortress 2 and Adult Swim bumper aesthetics, my main obsession was animal facts. I used to wake up early in the morning before class and sit down watching this certain show. Little fetus me loved snakes in particular, and I still think they're cool as hell. You look me straight in the eye and try to tell me a gaboon viper or a king cobra isn't the gnarliest shit alive!
I fucking kill you!
The thing, or things, really, that kickstarted this interest was the programming on Animal Planet. Nowadays, the channel's nothing but reality shows, but back then it was really something special. I wonder why it fell from grace like that. It's a complete mystery. If only we had someone to blame for this travesty. I guess we'll never know. Before all that, Animal Planet used to be a great place to learn about, well, animals. The channel was completely dedicated to educating the masses, and that's pretty cool. Personally, though, there were three shows I always gravitated towards. The yearly airings of the Puppy and Kitty Bulls, the Crocodile Hunter, who was pretty much the face of the network for a time and was my personal hero, and the topic of today's video, the Most Extreme. The Most Extreme was a show produced by Ian McGee and the Natural History New Zealand Company. The show itself ran for 77 episodes, spread across 5 seasons, and had the format of a top 10 list ranking animals on different factors.
Wow, a top 10 list, very daring today, aren't we?
If this show was done today, then sure, that'd be a fair criticism. Top 10 lists are dime a dozen. Hell, you can probably pick up 30 for a nickel, that's how saturated they are. But this show's from the early 2000s. July 2002, to be exact. Years before YouTube and the big boom of tier lists and top tens. Given that, it's original in a sense. Plus, this aired on television, so it could go all out on presentation and really stand out. Even just the intro was engaging. Just look at this.
Earth is a planet of extremes. Extreme places. And extreme animals. But some animals are more extreme than others. Join us as we count down to find the most unusual and the most extraordinary on Animal Planet's The Most Extreme.
Damn, dude! You didn't need to go this hard on a top 10 list. Mad props, respect the hustle. When it comes to the show's topics for ranking, they could range from simple things such as which animal can jump the highest, or which animal is technically the strongest, to more bizarre categories like what's the most disgusting animal, or what's the weirdest form of self-defense an animal can use. Even back then, with the more mundane topics, I adored this show. The producers really knew how to captivate the audience with their presentation. I especially liked the way the show went about showing off the animals. It's super intriguing. Not only would they show clips of the animals in their natural habitat, but they'd also incorporate public domain cartoons and stock footage as well, giving viewers a good multimedia mix to keep them invested. Alongside that is the show's own aesthetics. The green grid computer graphic style gives me massive Tron and Matrix vibes, and it's so late 90s, early 2000s. And also, the training stage for Marvel vs. Capcom 2. That's only because I've associated grid-like areas with this dumbass stage. Am I stupid? But I digress, back to the main topic. The narrator of this show is Adam J. Harrington. I haven't heard of him outside of the show, so I looked up his credits on Wikipedia. I'm surprised to see him still going strong with his career, even scoring some big gigs with the recent God of War games, so it's nice to see him still getting some work around the industry. This show and the aforementioned Crocodile Hunter were like crack for my young mind. It didn't matter when the shows aired or if they were just reruns, I was there no matter what. Back then, we had Dish Network, so I could DVR those shows without having to resort to anything drastic. But I absolutely would have. Don't fucking test me!
Yeah, champ, that's great! You gotta keep yammering and gonna talk about the funny CGI yet!
I was getting to that, jeez. These animations were a way to demonstrate the strange and incredible abilities of the animals each episode discussed, and interpret how a human with these same skills would look. Even with the context, these looked ridiculous, and I think that was the point. I can tell the people working on this show had just as much fun animating this shit as we are sharing them around all these years later. I hope they're happy to see their shots still floating around. Outside of that and the public domain assets, the show would also feature information on the places these animals lived in and the experts who studied them. They even had small interviews as well, although these weren't always with biologists, as they'd go with people that were related to the episode topic at hand, such as movie industry costume designs or medical experts. In the season 3 episode on The Most Extreme Bloodsuckers, for example, they found a guy who claimed to be a vampire and just let him fucking talk about it, apparently.
The vampire tradition survives today. The dark streets of New Orleans are home to a modern vampire, Tony Parker.
I've been a vampire most of my life. I would actually say since I was about 6. You're more or less born into it. It picks you. You don't pick to be one. I've bitten about 5 people. It was totally consensual. Usually we dated and either lived together or were just long-term partners. What people believe vampires are, the way they dress, the way they live, the way they are, the things that they do, it's completely out of the ordinary. And that is pretty much the way I live, actually. It's not what anybody would consider normal.
At least the biting was consensual, I guess. But the funniest part about this episode, to me, is that this interview segment isn't even about a bat. You know, the animal everyone associates with vampirism? Nah, instead they focus on a butterfly. I mean, shit, it does suck blood, and it's aptly named the vampire butterfly. I'm not gonna lie, that kinda goes hard, but still! If it wasn't for this show, there'd be dozens of cool and creepy animals I never would have learned about, like box jellyfish, anglerfish, water bears, or the hognose snake. Look at this silly bastard. Who does he think he's fooling? Honestly fucking incredible. I've moved on to other interests over the years, but the most extreme still has a place in my heart for starting that first passion for cool animal facts. Same with Steve Irwin. Of course, a show with a name like that will teach you some wild stuff, but fuck, just take the water bears I mentioned a little bit ago as an example. They can survive in the vacuum of space! They're extremely resilient to radioactivity for no goddamn reason, and if you dehydrated them alive, you could give them water over 100 years later, and they'd keep squishing along like it was no big deal. What the fuck? This little Michelin man looking bitch is radical! Sure, most of the facts I learned when I first watched this show fell out through my years and the years since, but that was to make room for vital and important information. Even so, I loved watching this show, and I still come back to rewatch it on rarities. Going back to them for this video in particular was a fun journey, being able to walk down memory lane and get just as invested in it as I first was all those years ago. Though before I sign off, I have a little surprise. I got curious during my rewatch and did some digging, and with the help of the Natural History New Zealand Company, I was able to get in touch with Ian McGee for a small interview. Here's how it went. How did The Most Extreme come to be? Did Animal Planet contact the company to make the show, or did you pitch a pilot to the network?
We had just finished the second series of a show called Twisted Tales for Animal Planet, which had been a success. It won Animal Planet their first Emmy Award. I picked up the trophy for writing the Twisted Tale of the Bat episode in the News and Documentary Emmy Awards. So, the execs at Animal Planet came to us to see how we would go about making a countdown show. We pitched our ideas, and The Most Extreme was born.
How was the experience working on the show? Were there any issues that were prevalent during its run, or some bits that were really funny while making it?
Working on the show was the most fun you could have with your clothes on. We had a simple rule of storytelling. leave out all the boring bits. So we spend our time trying to hunt down amazing stories about people and animals that made us go, wow. The biggest issue for the series is that we made the series in New Zealand, not America. And so we had to organize all our filming in the States from the other side of the world. And we had to learn how to write in American and not New Zealander. Some of the funniest bits were usually when we had to film recreations of people doing strange things to illustrate a story. Because we had a small budget, we couldn't afford to hire actors, so we used the crew instead. That's why in the most extreme hissy fits, you can see me losing my mind at a malfunctioning computer, bashing my head against a keyboard. It made for an entertaining shoot, and great blooper reels for the Christmas party. Another result of having a small budget is that sometimes when we brought in archive footage of old movies, we got the pictures but no sound. So we had to go into our sound suite and make up the sound effects ourselves. That's why one day, me and another writer went into the studio and pretended to have a kung fu fight. On another day, I had to come up with the sound effects for an emu mating in a stream. It's amazing what you can do with a feather duster and a bucket of water.
What were some of your favorite or least favorite episodes to work on?
It sounds trite, but they were all favorites. It's like trying to name your favorite child. If we had a problem episode, we worked damn hard to make sure it was no longer a problem.
Were there any episodes that you had planned before the show's run ended? If so, do you remember what they were?
I seem to remember that by the time season 5 was commissioned, we'd been told that there would be no more. So we hadn't developed any extra shows.
After all these years having made the show, how are things going for you? Are you working on or currently trying to get any shows made, as well as having anything to say as a send-off to the fans of the show?
It's been over 20 years since we were working on The Most Extreme. A few years after we finished, we got a lot of the band back together to create a children's television network called Zumu. We were making content for the channel that was broadcast in over 40 countries. The stories we were retelling were a lot like The Most Extreme, except we were aiming for young kids, and the hosts were puppets. We made almost 4,000 shows for that young age group, and applied the same storytelling rules. It can't be boring. As for a send-off message to the fans, I'd just like to say a heartfelt thank you. Without the fans, we would have been lucky to make one episode, let alone 5 seasons. I just hope everyone had as much fun watching as we did making.
It really means a lot to me as a lifelong fan of the show to see not only the creators still around, but also that they took time out of their day to answer my questions. Genuinely, it was awesome to see their answers, and it made me super happy. If there's any chance you're watching this, Ian, thank you and the rest of the team for making such a memorable and entertaining show all those years ago. I wish you all the best of luck. And thank you for sticking around to the end of the video. Unless you skip to the end like a rat bastard. This video has been in the production pipeline for months, and I'd like to thank Snickerpuff for all the new visuals and usual helping with the script, and both Rotting Coffee and ET for the voiceover work. That may come off as a bit strange since it's on the simpler side, but I've had some life stuff come up. Also, I'm pretty lazy by nature, but that wasn't the problem this time around, I swear! I've been wanting to expand my content outside of quick shit posts and TF2 related videos, and even experiment by putting my persona in them. So expect a wider breadth of topics going forward, and let me know what you think of this new style of editing. If you like this type of video or the topic, leave a comment or a like. I'm hoping I'm onto something good here. Have a good one.